it is talk time. A United Nations survey says every year about 1.2 million people die as a result of road crashes and about 20 million more suffer non-fatal injuries, which may result in permanent disability.
Now, this is attributed to overspeeding by road users. Let's see this report.
The FRSC Corps Marshal spoke through Deputy Corps Marshal Daniel Nwachukwu, who is in charge of administration and human resources. He said there is no going back on the deadline for the enforcement of speed limits on commercial vehicles. The Corps Marshal is pained that such high number of precious lives were lost due to overspeeding last year.
In 2015, speed contributed 26.5% of road crashes that led to death. Altogether, 68.8% of these speed-related causes were responsible for road crashes that led to so many deaths in 2015.
The sensitization program held at the Holy Ghost Park in Enugu, where one of the participating commercial drivers appealed to the FRSC to kindly extend the date for the speed limit enforcement.
I guess I want to urge that this enforcement be extended at least 1st January.
But Deputy Corps Marshal Nwachukwu said there will be no need for extension as enough sensitization has been made on the enforcement date.
How many times shall we continue to postpone this program? More so, we are coming to Ember Month when we know your speed is getting too much. You want to do many runs. We want to save Nigerian lives. We cannot, if you postpone it, we'll be allowing more people to die.
Other security agencies in Enugu State lend their support to the initiative, including the police, DSS, and Nigerian Security and Civil Defense Corps.
The Nigerian Police Enugu Command, we identify with everything that will give life.
So on behalf of the DSS, I want to say we work on the program. We are in touch with them and we are going to partner with them to make sure the program succeeds.
The Nigerian Security and Civil Defense Corps stands to support this program.
The October 1st new deadline for speed limits is coming after a final approval by President Muhammadu Buhari to FRSC to commence enforcement.
Imagine. Okay. All right, we have in the studio the Lagos State Sector Commander of the Federal Road Safety Commission, Hygienist Omeje. It's good to have you join us.
Good morning.
Did I get the name right?
Because
you
did this time. We're learning. We have to learn to pronounce it correctly.
No, but I love African names, and they have to be pronounced the way it's supposed to be.
Yes.
Omeje, you're welcome.
Thank you very much.
It's good to have you join us. And from our Abuja studio, we have Imo Etuk, who is the FRSC Core Public Education Officer in that command as well. Imo, it's good to have you join us. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you very much.
Very well.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now, hygienist, let's start it from here. We understand the speed limit device will be the implementation of speed limit device, the use of speed limit device will be on in October 1st?
October 1st.
October
yes.
1st.
Yes.
Now, tell us about it. Let us know what is the speed limit device. Let's understand basically what it is.
Well, the speed limit device, as we all know it, is just a technological device that we can use to check excessive speeding on our roads. It's a very small electronic device that, if properly installed in a vehicle at a preset speed, the driver accelerates and gets to that preset speed, it cannot go beyond that. Now, the mechanism of action differs depending on the type you use. Some will just cut off the fuel supply and the driver, the vehicle will not just go beyond that. The moment you come back to the normal speed, it restores the fuel and the vehicle, the supply and the vehicle goes. So the mechanism of action varies depending on what type you are installing, either in one of the electronic ones in this way or the manual vehicles, whichever one you are installing. But the key thing here is that it cuts off the speed, it prevents that vehicle from going beyond that set speed
use the word if properly installed. So it could be improperly installed.
I had to use the word if properly installed because the competence just have to be there in terms of the engineer that needs to install this very well. Everything in life, if you don't do it very well, you will not get the desired result. So if properly installed, this is the way it works. And what the car wants to simply achieve is crashing the speed before the speed crashes all of us. Let's just cut down on the speed of the motorists, the commercial fleet operators on our roads.
All right, tell us about the production. Producing Nigeria imported, how?
Well, for now, there is no company that has established its own factory here. So everything is imported for now. But before we got to this stage, I'm aware you know that we've had series of stakeholders, collaborations, of which the Standard Organization of Nigeria was also part of the technical committee on this speed limiting device policy. So everything that will be brought will be in line with SON approval and set standards. It must have the SON cap number to ensure that, you've gone through SON and you've certified that the device.
That's
for the vendors. Yes, that the Standard Organization of Nigeria has approved that, yes, this is what can come in into this country for us, that is good for us to use. And already you are aware that we have about 38 accredited vendors already who are into this program.
Okay, let me bring in Imoy Took here in our Abuja studio. He is the FRSC Core Public Education Officer. Now, Imoy, it's good to have you join us. Now let us understand. You'll be implementing the speed limit device implementation from October 1st. As it is right now, what's the level of compliance to the acquisition of this device in Abuja from what you've observed?
Thank you very much. Not only in Abuja, throughout the country, people have started buying into the idea of installing speed limiters. What we have now, there is a substantial level of compliance from ABC, Imo Transport. People have been complying. What we are telling Nigerians is that they can do a lot more because everything is predicated on the issue of safety. Just as the Sector Commander Lagos has said, speed is a major causative factor. So we intend to crash the speed before it kills people. So we are telling Nigerians we could do a lot more. What we are doing from October 1 is just to continue with our public enlightenment and do subtle enforcement. But we are telling Nigerians, please, commercial vehicles, go and install the speed limiters. There's a lot more to be done.
All right, so on the 1st of October, if a commercial vehicle doesn't have the speed limiter, what happens? What are the penalties?
Well, we'll counsel them. We'll counsel them. What we'll do, subtle enforcement. We'll continue with the public enlightenment. We'll do subtle enforcement. We ask them, you've not installed. It's a mechanism for us to check and say, please, go and install. So between now and the end of the year, what we'll be doing will be subtle enforcement of the speed limiting device.
Okay, let's understand. The speed limiting device is meant to prevent, like Hygienist has told us here, to prevent the driver from going beyond a certain limit. Now, give us the benchmark speed. What is supposed to be the benchmark speed where if he gets there, you should either cut off the fuel depending on the kind of device, or he stops the car or something, or he raises an alarm or something?
There's a preset limit. You know, for taxis and buses, expressways is 90 kilometers, and for trailers and tankers, 60, and for vehicles, 100. So the technicians would have fitted the speed limiting device to that level. So if you move, for instance, 100 kilometers and it sets at 100 and 105, 110. So when it blinks at that point in time, there's a signal and you cannot go beyond that level. So whether you accelerate and you keep accelerating, it will not move because it's already been preset.
Okay.
All right.
So what we are telling commercial vehicles, don't tamper with the equipment, don't tamper with the ones that have already been installed, because at a certain point, you cannot go beyond that preset limit.
Okay. All right, Mr. Omeje, now tell us where you have a case of armed robbery or kidnapping or security issues where the driver may need to go beyond the set limit. What happens?
I think what we should be looking at here, I've been confronted with this severally each time this kind of discussion comes on. And to the best of my knowledge, I've had cases or heard of cases where armed robbers, if they are after you and they catch up with you, I think what they usually say is, your hands up, oh yeah, give us all you have, blah, 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 blah. They will remove possessions. And if you don't resist, you don't do anything, they just take what they want to take. If they can't,
have you been a victim of armed robbery?
Hold on, I've had experience once. I've had experience once while on patrol. But at that point in time, they were not after us for anything. It was just that they felt we know that they have passed and to demobilize, dispossess the victims of their properties. More often than not, it's not life. They are not after life. They are after something. They are after the car, or they are after what? Maybe they are acting on information. There is the vehicle has money or anything. When they get there, they remove those things, and the life is still preserved. Now, you now say you want to say, because you feel these people that are following you, that they are armed robbers, and you want to overspeed. There have been cases where people, in the course of trying to overspeed like that, you want to evade armed robbery attack, they crash. They die in the process. The armed robbers get there. What do? They just come out and pass. They don't even dare to stop them. But I can assure you that if you had, let's assume that they catch up with you, you cooperate, okay, they give you whatever. But I think it is a case of out of two greater evils, you have to choose a lesser one.
Mm. I've been a victim of armed robbery. And yes. when they stopped our car, it wasn't a case of just bring what you had. They, in fact, for 2 weeks, I couldn't turn my neck because they hit me with a gun on my neck.
Were you trying to resist?
No.
But okay. No. But you were alive to tell the story.
Yes. No, really. So let's be okay. Let's be very factual
but,
here.
But because sometimes could you also imagine you now wanting to evade them? Can you also imagine wanting to evade them and think you can match them speed by speed, and in the process, you lost control of that vehicle?
The other car was able to swerve.
And some assaulted.
The other car was able to swerve and narrowly miss them.
There was another car
was able to swerve and narrowly miss them, and he escaped.
Well, that's life for you. Some go free over certain things, some fall victim of things, and we do fall victim of so many things.
All right, but here,
I think we should just put these things on the scale properly. For us, it is about preserving life more than anything.
Hygienist, let me ask you this. At the point of installation of this equipment or this device, Imo has given us the 90 or 80 kilometer per hour, 100 kilometer per hour, 60 kilometer, depending on whatever vehicle has the case may be. Now, if for instance, in my car, I want to install this, and the speed limit
Remember that we are still talking about commercial fleet operators. I don't know whether you are now a commercial fleet operator.
Or if I have a commercial fleet operator, for instance.
Okay.
And the speed limit is supposed to be 100. And at the point of installation, I decide, okay, why don't you raise it up a little to about 110?
No.
But how do you monitor that?
Point of correction.
Okay.
Like what the Corps Public Education Officer said, two factors determine your speed at any point in time. Number one, in this case, the category of vehicle, and two, the road you are using. If you had one him very well, for taxis, buses on our expressway, 90 is the max. That's the maximum. For private cars on our expressway, 100 is the max. So we are not talking about private cars now. So we are looking at commercial buses on our expressway, maximum 90. Tankers and trailers, maximum 60. If you go to the highway, you will discover that the same bus that on the expressway that can go 90, max is 80. So we are going to use the maximum benchmark here, which is 90. Now, so that even if you veer into highway, or you are on the express, or you are moving from highway to express, or we move from expressway to, either way, you are still on the safe line. And now, maximum, all of them are supposed to set on 90 for those category of buses. Tankers and trailers set on 60. Now, there is no issue of saying, can I turn it a little bit to 95 or 100? Mm-hmm. 90 is what the law approves. So put it at 90. Now, for us, let me tell you, those speed limiting devices, they have a port where we can put a USB can be put, and our guys that with their tablets, the moment they plug our tablets to that USB port, you will see not only the speed that vehicle have made at that point in time that you are checking it, but for the past 3 days, the speed it has been making consistently. Then some of these speed limiting devices, depending on the type you have, also have a printer attached to it that you can also activate and even have a printout of what the speed that vehicle have been making, not only for that period that you stopped it, for even for the past 3 days, you can get it like that. It's important that we get it. These are the monitoring mechanisms. At the other back end, the moment the man also installs, there is a portal that the vendor uploads the information on those vehicles to our own portal. And with the tablet that our men have on the road, if they key in the number of that vehicle, they will be able to know, oh, this vehicle is already fitted with a speed limiting device or not. The field commands have also been equipped with radar guns. So the radar guns will be on the road. And as you are coming, the guys might just decide to focus the radar gun on your vehicle. And if it is also going above what is supposed to go on that road, it raises up alarm also, and the guys will flag you up. But one thing is very certain. Nigerians should not expect that come October 1, FRSC will just roll out all its equipment on the road and go and impound all the commercial fleet operators because they have not got there.
Okay.
The commercial have been very explicit about it. It's going to be advisory enforcement initially. Yeah. Advisory enforcement. We can flag you down. Remember that these things are also installed all where right. We can see.
Okay.
So we can also even visually see it. If it's installed, we can see it. And we can now say, oh, why have you not installed?
Okay.
The most important thing is, let's
bring in right. Mr. Etuk in yes. here right now. Mr. Etuk, let's talk about the price of these devices. How much is it? From the report we got, it's about 36,000. Is that correct?
The road safety does not determine the prices of these products. Determined by the market forces, which the marketers, 38 of them, the vendors, are at liberty to set depending on the various market forces. So the FRSC does not fix the price. We are just a body to ensure safety standards with the NADDC and the Standard Organization of Nigeria, joint bodies to ensure that standards are met. But for costing, the FRSC, SON, and NADDC, we're not involved.
Okay, now let's talk about the court case about this speed device. There was a court case, a particular NGO or activist took the FRC to the court over this. Was there a court case?
There was a court case, and we won. The court said FRC, within the context of the FRC Establishment Act, that we have a mandate to enforce the use of seatbelts, because it is there clearly stated in the FRSC Establishment Act. So somebody went to court. That was almost at the same time when we were also in the House, when there's a public hearing going on it. Then after the public hearing, the House of Reps also gave us a clean bill of health that, look, we think this is good for Nigerians, because the whole essence of public hearing was, Nigerians, come and tell us your view about it. And everybody, the voice was unanimous that I think we should, people said, look, I think FRSC, they are on course. Whatever we need to do to save lives on our roads, so be it. And the House have no other option but to give us a clean bill of health. Okay. Somebody also, at that same point, went to court to challenge us legally. And we also matched him met him in the court, and at the end of the day, the court said, look, within the context of FRSC, the constitutional provision of the court, within the confines of the FRSC establishment Act 2007, we are good to go.
Okay. Right. Let me ask Imo this question before I let him go. Imo, when it comes to enlightenment, no amount of enlightenment can be enough. Are there any other agencies that the FRSC is collaborating with to ensure that this enlightenment is carried out adequately?
Thank you very much. Just last week, there was a technical agreement with the Consumer Protection Council to ensure that we educate Nigerians on all that they need to know on the speed limiters and all other products of the core. Right now, every week on radio and on TV, the Consumer Protection Council and the Federal Road Safety are in agreement to ensure that we educate Nigeria, and we'll keep doing it. Don't forget, enlightenment is an ongoing process. We go to motor parks, there are advocacy visits to mosques and churches.
We don't have that on our TV
yet. We go to traditional rulers, we go to...
We don't have that yet on our TV.
Stakeholders to ensure that we educate people. So, whether it is TVC or Radio Park, or a rally at Jabi Park, or at or Jota, or wherever, the core will consistently continue to educate Nigerians on all they need to do. Don't forget, speed limiters are not just on their own. Speed limiters comes with other aspects of safety. Overloading, the use of seat belt, driving under the influence of drugs and alcohol, ensuring that your vehicles are in top shape, ensuring that your tires are okay. So not just speed limiter, it's a whole gamut of safety measures to ensure that we stay alive. People should not look at the cost, should not look at the inconvenience, they should look at the safety at the end of the day, because we are out to ensure the safety of Nigerians. We are not out to exploit Nigerians, but their safety is paramount to us.
All right, Imoy Took, FRSC Core Public Education Officer, thank you for joining us on TVC Breakfast.
Thank you, it's my pleasure.
All right, let's give you some background information. Now, the Federal Road Safety Commission, as the lead government agency saddled with the responsibility of road traffic management in Nigeria, has identified speed as a major contributing factor to road crashes and attendant casualties in Nigeria.
To this extent, the Commission has advised commercial vehicle owners to comply with the October 1st deadline for the installation of speed-limiting devices in their vehicles, saying it will be total and non-compromising, and defaulters will be arrested and prosecuted. But they said now that, okay, it's going to be a subtle enforcement, okay?
Yeah, between now and December, it's still going to be, you know, enlightenment and all of that. So maybe from January 1st,
yes,
there could be the issue of outright prosecution.
We don't know,
but Omeje will tell us that.
We said advisory enforcement.
All right, okay.
Advisory enforcement.
All right. Now, but according to the FRSC, the focus is more on commercial vehicles because commercial vehicle drivers are the major road users that are prone to road crashes as a result of their poor knowledge of road signs, since majority of them are illiterates and lack courtesy while on the wheel sometimes. This is relative anyway.
All right, the enforcement of speed limiters was initially slated for June 1st, 2015, but the date had to be extended to allow for further consultation and more public enlightenment programs. As of January this year, there were 16 approved speed limited vendors. What we have now, about 38,
it's increased. More players are coming in.
All right, good. So here are some of the approved vendors we have in Lagos and Abuja.
All right, you have that basic information there. Let me bring in Foladele in here to give us a basic understanding of how Nigerians are reacting. Fola, where is Fola? Fola, where are you?
I'm right here.
Are you sure you weren't driving and you were hiding something from Major here?
Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Busala.
Good morning. Good morning, Agnes. Lovely to see you again. Wow, we're talking about speed limit devices. Mm-hmm. And You know, when you first hear about this, you're led to think, oh, well, this could be good on our roads in the long run.
Yeah.
But you might be surprised that quite a number of Nigerians are not quite excited about this.
They're not smiling.
And these tweets only represent a few of those reactions. But let's check them out. First one from at Arthur Oates Vent, who's, you know, tweeting this directly at you guys. He's saying, FRSC, be concerned with road safetyness rather than bringing up means to extort people. What's a speed limit device? Next one from at Uchmania, who's saying, well, FRSC should have started by ensuring all roads have the speed signs showing the speed limit. Next one from at Buraimo Dariamo, who's saying, FRSC speed limit enforcement comes October 1st is another way of creating hardship if the cost is passed to motorists. At Idre says, shouldn't a speed limiter be people's individual? Who's saying, FRSC speed limit enforcement comes October 1st is another way of creating hardship if the cost is passed to motorists. At Idre says, shouldn't a speed limiter be people's individual choices? And he goes on to say, why make speed limiter compulsory when you can build good roads to reduce road accidents? Might want to take that up later.
Yes.
And I'm sure you do. And the last one from at Fatwas16 says, first it was new driver's license, then encoders, then new license plates, and now speed limit device. Seriously, FRSC, you need to stop. Stop.
Stop.
No, I won't stop until crashing stops to claim lives on our roads.
So you wanted to address the tweet about our bad roads.
That's an interesting aspect of this discussion. Now, I will use Lagos-Ibadan as a case study. Let me not even go to any other road, but I can also give you another road in Lagos also. Lagos-Ibadan, before rehabilitation, the whole road stretch was bad. Then the federal government awarded contract and divided it from Sagamu upwards to Ibadan, RCC handling them, and we joined Julius Berger. Now, go and check the road if you are going to Ibadan from Sagamu upwards. You notice that some good, reasonable portions, about 60% of those segments have been properly rehabilitated. And we're still having issues at this end. Now, where we have been having the highest number of fatal cases has been between that axis that is properly rehabilitated. So you notice that the more the road gets better, the more people speed.
Right.
And the more they crash, and those crashes are always fatal.
Okay.
Now, the crashes we record between Sagamu towards Berger, they are not as fatal as those ones that we record between Sagamu towards Ibadan, where the road segments
are. So you're saying when the road is bad, it forces you to not speed?
You now discover that it is not about, once the road is good, people tend to overspeed. The road is bad, people tend to be, you know, careful.
You should our road stay bad.
But then, I give you another road. Lekki Epe, you recall how Lekki Epe was before. Now, after the concessional of Lekki Epe, go and check the crashes that happened on Lekki Epe. The severity index have always been higher because it's more fatal now. And almost on every weekend, you go there, you see people crashing into the curb as a result of overspeeding. That's just it. If you also look at Benin Ore, where we have fatal cases from areas between after Ore down towards Benin axis, as if we are going to the east, where the road is already properly rehabilitated, expanded and rehabilitated. From Ore, Ijebode axis, where they are still working on, you don't have that kind of fatal crashes along that axis. So where does that lead us to? You now notice that only God knows, by the time this express road, the Lagos-Ibadan, is fully expanded, you know, the lanes are also good. They are adding additional lane, and they are going to really actually resurface all of them. We will still be here. I hope God keeping us together. We'll come back here again and compare notes. And you notice that if we don't do what we are doing now, then the fatality index on that road and any other road as they are being rehabilitated and getting better is going to be terribly high.
All right, Fala, thank you.
Thank you, Mike. I do want to ask him about the cost and all that.
Before you answer that of the cost, before you get to the cost, there's been quite a lot of policies, change of policies, change of driver's license, change of plates. And
plate numbers.
You're not giving Nigerians for free.
And the cost is on the motorists.
You're not giving us for free. Now, this is around again. The motorists will have to bear the brunt of the pain. When will it, if you need to perhaps stick to a particular policy and stop introducing new ones, if you have to introduce new one, then maybe subsidize the cost.
Excuse me. I thought they said that the only thing permanent in life is change. Mm. You keep on changing. As things change, you also change and move into better. What are we just trying to do? Technology is ruling the whole world. And man is benefiting a lot from technology. We are still taking advantage of technology to solve a particular problem. Now, the issue of in all those policies that we came up with, why did you establish FRSC? To just come and sit down in the offices and be drinking decaffeinated coffee? No. Go out there, conduct research. That is part of what the constitutional mandate says. Conduct researches on the causes of road traffic crashes. Come up with solutions. Mm. Come up with solutions.
We'll take it from here. You can go now. Thank you. Now, Hyginus, let's take it from the point of buying a car, for instance. Mm-hmm. You buy a car, you need particulars. You're going to pay about, I wouldn't know what it is right now, but there's some amount of money you have to pay. Your driver license is there. The number plates are there. So you end up paying, you finish buying the car, you end up paying about 100, 200,000 naira for all of this. How do you think people are going to cope with all of this in the presence of the current situation we find ourselves?
Now, who knows? In the next 2 years, you might change the plate numbers again. Okay, there we go.
Nobody puts his hand to build a house that does not sit down first and foremost.
And count the cost.
Okay. The day you decide to buy a car, that you want to ride a car on Nigerian road, also sit back and count the cost of what it will take you to put that car on the road. There's nowhere in the world where people don't pay road tax. Some of those things you are asking for this, they are simple tasks that you pay inadvertently or using government facilities. For example, you must renew your vehicle license and it must be done yearly. You must renew your insurance papers. Are you now saying you're not going to have insurance? Will the vehicle be insured? Won't you insure your life and insure the life of the other person just in case the unexpected happens? You're going to also have a driver's license. The driver's license is the only valid legal document that permits you to drive on the road. All over the world, you cannot be on the road without having a driver's license. So I don't know the furoro about they came up with a driver's license. Our driver's license was simply made to come up with international standards. Today, if you leave the shores of this country and you turn in your driver's license, they swap it, they see the information, you are good to go. When we were carrying, is it the paper license that we should have used to be carrying in the 21st century? No. I don't think Nigeria deserves that.
Okay. So, now, besides the commercial...
We have not still addressed the cost.
Yes. Address the cost for us.
How when we started really? This discussion, she asked me, are we manufacturing this thing here? I said no. So, you could also now imagine that if we are not manufacturing it and we are bringing it in, then the dollar exchange rate will just be the main determinant factor. The people will also buy according to the dollar, the exchange rate as they got it before going there. So let's leave the market forces to determine some of these things. Initially, it might look as if it is costly, but let me ask you, how much is your life worth?
It's priceless, I know.
It's priceless. End of discussion.
All right. In our next discussion on this, we would like you to bring us one of the devices so that we can see, so the Nigerians can get to see maybe different kinds, so they can.
I think what we can even do is will it be proper because even the vendors now they have an umbrella body. Okay. Will it be proper for me to bring one of them alongside so that they can come with all these devices, the different types and all those ones. Don't forget that I'm just a government official implementing government policy. I am not expected to be buying vendors or selling vendors. So if I really have to come with one, I need to come with one vendor. He's not going to come here to market anything. We don't want to know who he is.
But he can pay us money to market. He can pay us money to market. All right, Hygienist Omeje, thank you very much. Hygienist, thank you very much for coming on the program. It's always interesting having you around.
And let me say this. You were asking, who are the agencies, other agencies involved in this public like me? You forgot that you are number one.
You're waiting for the candidates.
So thank you for your support.
Thank you.
Because through this program, Nigerians are getting more informed. It's all part of the campaign. It's all part of the awareness.
Thank you.
And TVC have always consistently been there for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hygienist. Thank you. And we wish you well too. All right. This is where we come to the end of today's edition of the program. And don't forget, all eyes are on Edo State for the election today. And the state has been shut down. Movement is no longer allowed until about 6 p.m. in the evening. So keep watching and get to know what's happening in Edo State. Our reporters are everywhere. Every
As
single local
fact,
government.
Edo decides open a couple of minutes from now.
Exactly.
Really. The studio opens.
We're going to give you
analysis.
Exactly. So, yeah.